Hi everyone. Hopefully everyone can hear me. This is Tara Galeska and I'm the section manager for the Salmon program. Welcome to the 2015 application workshop. We have about 50 people that have enrolled and 42 online currently. This is a kind of a new format for us. We've been doing it for the last couple of years and hopefully it's saving time, travel, and is an efficient way to get you the information you need about the Salmon Recovery Funding Board workshops. For those folks that want to leave early, or if you just want to listen and watch the presentation again later or look at the slides, we plan on recording this session, and we will be posting links to this workshop on the Recreation and Conservation website, hopefully next week or as soon as it's available. We'll also be sending out a link to the presentation to everybody who's in attendance today, after we've loaded the presentation to the website. There's a lot of information we're planning on covering today. We hope to make it within the 2-hour time frame. And again, if there's something you miss, we'll make it available on the website. Another thing I wanted to just mention, if you have any questions during the WebEx, you can go ahead and type them in that chat space on your computer on the WebEx GoToMeeting slide bar on the right side of your screen. And we're going to have someone answering those questions live in the chat room area of the webinar. Kat Moore is going to be answering those questions. Everyone here in the room, we have all of the Salmon grant managers currently in the room, as well as Amy Barr, our admin person, and myself, the section manager. So we're all going to be taking turns going through the slideshow in different sections. So I'm going to advance to the next slide and talk about what the webinar will plan on covering. If you're here today, we're assuming that you're interested in applying for a 2015 Salmon Recovery Grant or just getting a refresher on the kinds of projects that we implement. We'll be going over the general program and policies, which are covered in Manual 18, and we'll also mention some of the other manuals that we use to manage our active grants. We will be talking about the application process and requirements. We'll highlight recent changes from 2014 to 2015. So if you're a repeat applicant, we'll cover some of those things you might want to have attention to. And if you're a first-time applicant, we're going to be going through everything. We'll also be talking about the PRISM online application format. I believe this is the second year we've used the PRISM online application. We're moving, if some of you haven't noticed, we're moving a lot of PRISM to an online format, including electronic billing. So there's a lot that you can do now online through our website and through our database. It's also important to let you know that a lot of this information is available all of the information is available on the RCO website, and particularly on different project types. If you have an acquisition project, for example, or a restoration project, all of those manuals are available online, so you know what you're getting into when you apply for an RCO grant in terms of project type. We'll also talk a little bit about other RCO grant programs available in 2015 in case you can expand your grant portfolio in the RCO. So I talked a little bit about this, but this is just a general overview of the agenda for the workshop and how we will flow with the information. So each heading here is a different section of the workshop, and different grant managers in the room will go through each of those sections in more detail. So I'm giving you a little bit of an agency overview. We'll talk about grant requirements, process, eligible projects and applicants, the actual application, and then we'll go into a little bit of detail about the expectations of a project once it gets funded, where you can turn for technical assistance, a little bit on how to use PRISM, and again, the questions you can do online right now in an active format. So after you take today's workshop, we hope that you'll become familiar with our role as grant managers and as the agency, the Recreation and Conservation Office. We hope you're familiar with the application and the review process, up to date on information and recent changes, and that you know where to find key information. We'll typically have website resources on each slide as relevant, so you can go back and look at some of those websites to find more specific information. You'll have an understanding of how we can assist you as grant managers and as an agency. We'll go over some of the important application deadlines, and by the end we hope you can develop and submit a complete application. And of course, RCO grant managers are always here to assist you if you have specific issues that you run into as you apply for a SRF board, Salmon Recovery Funding Board grant. We'll be using a lot of acronyms, so type away if you have questions on those. Just wanted to give you a little bit of information about the agency as a whole. We have two major grant sections, the Recreation and Conservation section, which are administered through the Recreation and Conservation Funding Board, as well as this program here, Salmon Recovery, and our program is administered through the Salmon Recovery Funding Board, and we also house the Governor's Salmon Recovery Office in the RCO. Again, you can see a website on the slide that will give you a little bit of more information about the board should you be interested in looking at those. This slide just kind of shows all the relevant salmon-related RCO grant programs, and some of these are in the RCFB side of the agency. I did want to point out that today's workshop will be focusing just on the SRF board grants, but if you have restoration projects or salmon recovery projects, other programs that you might be interested in are the WWRP program. They have some restoration categories, the Aquatic Lands Enhancement Account. Those two programs are administered through the RCFB. We also have a Family Forest Fish Passage program and the Estuary and Salmon Restoration Program. Those two programs are not administered by the SRF Board, but are applicable towards salmon recovery, so they might be something you're interested in. And again, we'll be talking about SRF Board grants as well as Puget Sound Acquisition and Restoration grants here. That is the those are the programs that are open right now for applications. The types of grants that are available through the SRF Board are acquisition grants, planning grants, which encompass designs, and restoration grants. We also have applications for a combination grant, which may include acquisition and restoration or acquisition and planning. If you don't know a lot about salmon recovery in the state, there's some good resources on our website. You should know that Washington is broken out into 8 salmon recovery regions, as shown on the slide here. And within those regions, there are 26 lead entities. Probably Puget Sound being the most complex region with 15 lead entities within Puget Sound. And so one important thing to note is that each lead entity has a specific a grant process specific to that lead entity. So you will have to work with your local lead entity to submit an application through them and work with them on their local deadlines. And then we have our overarching agency deadlines. So those are really important contacts, are your lead entity coordinators. The Salmon Recovery Funding Board is the board that administers and approves funding for our agency for the salmon money. And we've got 5 non-voting natural resource agency representatives and 5 voting citizen members. And so your project applications will come before the board typically in December to be approved for funding. So applications here in the agency are due in August, and then the funding decisions are made in December after a thorough review process. So I think I'll turn it over now to Mark Dubojski, and he's going to go over the grant requirements for this portion of the workshop. So thank you for coming and being interested in our program, and we look forward to working with you.
Hello, everyone. Just want to remind you to ask Kat some questions and just make sure that you type your question clearly. We got a lot of experts in the room. If I don't know the question, I'm sure somebody else will. Or if I say something wrong, I'm sure somebody in the room will correct me. That's a given. Right, Elizabeth? Anyways, I'm going into grant requirements. You can always go to our website and tap into the Salmon Recovery section. This provides you all the relevant manuals and checklists and project proposal materials that you will need as you begin to navigate through the 2015 grant cycle. This is what I'm going to cover. It's pretty straightforward as we walk through these, and a lot of our policies and procedures have not changed. I will try to identify the ones that are new or new within the last one or two grant cycles. For projects, these are the basic tenets of what our program's all about and what you need to do to be able to apply for a grant. Some of the key items are you need to ask for at least $5,000. I don't know if I've ever seen a request that low. What's our average request right now? It used to be in the $250,000 to $300,000 range. So our requests are pretty high. You have to provide at least 15% match, which is a low match requirement compared to the Recreation and Conservation Funding Board side of our office. Most of their programs are like 50% match. I'll go over more match later. And need to complete your grant within 2 to 3 years, preferably closer to the two-year timeline. And then for restoration projects, you need to be able to commit to at least 10 years of stewardship after project completion. Here's who's eligible, pretty much everybody but federal agencies. However, you can do a project on federal land. You just need to find an eligible sponsor. We have quite a few of arrangements on federal land. Private landowners, you'll note right about in the middle of the screen, they are eligible. We've probably had 6 or 7 over the years that have applied. It's really onerous for them to navigate the whole grant process from beginning to end. So when you're making your application, you have to have certain control of your site, and the easiest is if you own the property, then you have full control for whatever you're proposing to do on the property. If you don't have ownership, then you need to get the landowner's consent to actually apply for the grant. We call it a landowner acknowledgement form. This doesn't commit the landowner to actually implementing or allowing something on their property yet. All this says is that they know there's a grant application being submitted for a certain type of project. Then if you are successful in receiving funding, then before construction, you will need to actually get the landowner agreement form signed, and that spells out that the project's going to be implemented and what the responsibilities are for the landowner versus the sponsor. And the key is you got to get that in before construction, and if you don't, then you won't be reimbursed for any construction costs if we don't have that landowner agreement form. So now if you're working on public land, you're going to want to make sure you're contacting the whatever agency you're working with, or even some land trusts that have used surfboard money in the past to acquire the property. You're going to be wanting to work closely with them just to make sure there's no conflict of any public uses on the public land or any other uses on some other properties that we've helped acquire. You just want to make sure that what you're proposing is consistent with what's currently taking place on the land. State-owned aquatic lands puts you in the DNR world, Department of Natural Resources, and you need to get a hold of your aquatic land manager as early as possible, because this will help help you plan and design any projects on state-owned aquatic lands. You will need the DNR. If it's determined it's on state-owned aquatic lands, you will need DNR to submit a form at our final application deadline. Later, you will need to get an official use authorization from DNR. And you can see the examples on the screen. Is there any questions so far?
You're rocking.
Kat is waiting, so am I. All right, match. This is always a fun question. What's eligible as match? I like to say virtually everything, but not everything. The key is it's got to be an eligible activity. This has to be part of the scope of work. It can't be something outside the grant agreement. And it also needs to come in the form of I think that's the next screen. It can come in the form of either cash or other grants. Even within our own agency, you can use our other side of the agency's grants to match ours. Our general rule is any funds that the surf board administers cannot match their own programs. But anything that's under the RCFB, ALEA, WWRP, as Tara noted, those are eligible to match. Mike Ramsey manages the ESRP, the Estuary Salmon Program. That's eligible to match. So those are a couple of examples. You could donate some of your labor or equipment to the project. You can see all sorts of match options on the screen. If you ever have a question on third-party match that's coming from another organization, always call your grant manager or email us, because that's always good to get clarification on before you try to use it as match for reimbursement later. A couple items that don't count are some of the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation Community Salmon Funds. They originated from us, and so if those are still lingering out there, check with us to make sure that that's not some of our money, because that won't be able to match our funds. The big one, and the one that gets a little tricky, is anything to do with mitigation that's come down from a regulatory agency for some sort of violation or so forth. That's not eligible as match. One thing that is eligible, because it's more of a programmatic type mitigation, we do allow is anything from hydropower companies, BPA on the east side of the mountains, Seattle City Light, Tacoma Power, PSE, through their relicensing process, they've put a certain amount of money each year or every couple years into a habitat fund to go either purchase property or to use for restoration. We do allow that as match because it's not site specific. It's for a whole watershed or a whole program. There are some exceptions where you don't need any match. I think I'll get into in a few more slides, but in a nutshell, you can apply for a design only project. It has to be a preliminary or final design to be eligible for that program, and I'll give you more details in a moment. And then if you're doing a project with a large industrial timberland owner like Weyerhaeuser, Longview Fiber, so forth, and you're doing a fish passage project, that requires 35% match. If you're doing a sediment reduction project for like on the road system, then that's a 50% match. And again, all these requirements that we'll be going over through all these slides are spelled out in our manual 18. If you do get a grant from us, we're reimbursement only, meaning you have to expend the funds, pay your contractors, and then ask for us to reimburse you after you submit all the proper forms. There are some eligible pre-agreement expenses that we do allow. For example, on an acquisition project, if you couldn't wait to go through the whole 12-month grant cycle with us, you could go purchase the property. As long as you get a waiver from us before you close on the property, then it remains eligible for either reimbursement or as match. You're not guaranteed that you'll get our funding. It just keeps it eligible. And it actually keeps it eligible for 2 years, two grant cycles. So if you got one this year, you'd be eligible for the 2015 and 2016 cycle. Design and engineering costs are eligible as long as the pre-agreement costs or for the actual design that you're asking us for restoration money for. It can't be so outside the scope of the restoration project. And then, as always, we always hold retainage until the project's completed and we get out there and inspect the finished product. This has been a big push over the last two or three biennium that we really need people to implement their projects as quick as possible. You need to be ready to go. If you're envisioning your project's going to take 4 or 5 years during your application this year, don't apply. We want stuff that can be implemented in 2 or 3 years. you should be able to have a pretty good idea, especially on restoration projects. You either have a conceptual design done, or you have a preliminary or final design already done, and that's coming in with your grant application, because then you really will only need one or two in-stream work windows, summer construction seasons, to complete your project. The days of getting a 4- and 5- and 6-year-old grant from us are long gone. Long-term obligations. For acquisition projects, that's kind of a simple answer. It's forever, perpetuity. For restoration projects, I mentioned this earlier, it's 10 years for stewardship and maintenance of the site. And the 10-year time clock starts after we make our final payment to you. And then the 10-year clock starts. So you can talk to your grant manager more about this type of detailed information in the landowner agreement, because again, you need to have that submitted after you've received the grant, but before you go to construction. Compliance issues come up every now and then, primarily on acquisition sites where you're there's an incompatible use going on, and then you'll have to work with us and our compliance staff to work through the mitigation for any issues we find. And there are exceptions to the rule, and those are listed. And basically, those affect restoration projects. All right, next I'm going to jump into the actual process. But before we do so, Kat has a question.
Yeah, I got a couple comments, questions. One was when the landowner acknowledgement form is due, if it's due at pre-application time or at the final, and I responded that for RCO, we just need them at the final. However, some lead entities might require them for their pre-application, so before the site visits. Also, you might get a comment from the review panel that you don't have a landowner acknowledgement form in at the site visit time. They usually just do this as a heads up to remind you that you'll need one at final. So don't take that as you did something wrong. It's just they often remind you. And then I got a question about pre-agreement costs, whether or not a conceptual design cost would be eligible as match for a final design grant. And the answer is it can be. You need to identify this in your proposal and discuss it with your grant manager to make sure that we can approve it as a pre-agreement cost to make sure it's identified in your agreement. So that when we go under agreement, you can bill for those costs. So yeah, those are the two questions we've had so far.
Thank you. A lot of you, if you're familiar with the surfboard process, have seen this chart. We're using last year's numbers, which are pretty much the numbers we use every year. We usually count on an $18 million statewide grant cycle, and each region has their allocation percentage. And so using last year's numbers, this is what we would project for this year for each region to be able to allocate. Now, there's three processes that actually go on at the same time. There's actually, I would say, two. There's the lead entity process and then our process, because the staff and the review panel work hand in hand. And staff, myself and all the other grant managers, we're looking to help you strengthen your proposal, to figure out how to make sure you get all the right information submitted on time and whether it's eligible. The review panel is going to be looking at the technical merits of the project and giving you feedback on whether your projects, as proposed, is going to have a high likelihood of achieving your goals and objectives. And so that's the type of feedback they will be giving you. Please contact your lead entity as soon as you can. I think a lot of lead entity coordinators have already sent out their timelines. So you should know when the local letters of intent, the draft applications are due. You should be starting to get communications about when your early site visits are, where staff and the review panel teams come out and visit each site. So if you don't know any of this information in your area, then you can call us. We can hook you up with who you need to get a hold of, or you can go on our website, find your lead entity contact, and get a hold of them.
They should know that those are already scheduled. So review panel site visits are scheduled all around the state with your lead entity currently. So there's calendar dates out there.
Now, the lead entity has a huge role. I mean, you have to initiate everything with them, and they will help you navigate getting your project identified in the Habitat work schedule, unless you're in Lower Columbia. I have no idea what they do. I hope Jeff and Melody are online. And then you'll get your PRISM application. And once you have your PRISM application number, then that's when you can start entering information into our database. And you don't have to complete an application right away. You can work on it over multiple days and long periods of time. The lead entity coordinates the review process. What they do is basically make sure all your projects and all the information for your project are getting the local technical review teams so you can get reviewed and evaluated and ranked. And then those rankings end up going to the Citizens Committee, and the Citizens Committee does the final ranking. And once the final ranking's complete, then the ranked lists get submitted to us in the late summer, early fall. You can see on here there's other site visits that we've already mentioned and application type information. Already hit on some of these items that we do. We're definitely here to hold you accountable and monitor progress of your project. If you are successful and get a grant with us, then we definitely are here to make the process of getting your grant funds reimbursed to you as smooth as possible. We'll also help coordinate having your designs reviewed by our review panel or any other technical folks if necessary. And then we're also here to make sure that any of your acquisition projects follow all of our detailed acquisition procedures. And then obviously at the close of your grant, we'll be there to help you wrap it up. We definitely need a new picture. This is our technical review panel. They're here to provide feedback. And like I mentioned, they're looking at benefits to salmon and certainty of success. And they're really going to emphasize this year, and I mentioned it, how your proposal is going to achieve your objectives, your goals and your objectives. And that's what their technical criteria is going to be based on. They also occasionally help us review contract amendments in the future. Once you're under contract, if you have a scope change or you have a cost change, we may elect to use them to review the changes. Here's the process. You're in the center. Go up, hang a right, circle around to the left, and back to the pot of gold. Some key dates. These are primarily our key dates. Again, get a hold of your dates at your local level. Final apps are due August 14th. You'll see the review panel comment forms. Is that the draft or the final? That must be like the draft. Then the October 2nd, you have 11 days, which always feels tight, so please plan ahead right now. Pencil out this time frame because you never know if you're going to have issues come up with our panel that time of year, and it is a tight time frame to get responses back. Then the regional area meetings are in late October, where if you're still having technical issues on your project and you maybe have a project of concern, the POC, you may have to come to Olympia and discuss the issues with our full review panel. And then you see that funding will be awarded December 9th and 10th this year. All right, is there any questions?
Yeah, it's hard to hear me apparently, so I'm going to come over here. We had a question about monitoring eligibility, and since this has just been approved by the SERP board, I'm not sure if we have
a specific call-out slide for this. We're developing the process for monitoring eligibility as we speak. We'll be uploading a frequently asked questions or fact sheet on our website with details about monitoring. But I just want to clarify a little bit. Monitoring projects are specifically about monitoring. This does not add a work type to an otherwise restoration project or acquisition project. So it's a discrete monitoring project, and there's criteria that our board approved that monitoring project needs to follow. So those are in our board minutes, which are on our website, which we could take some time and show you that in a little bit. But we will have something on our website. Applications for monitoring, where you'll go through a similar process on PRISM, and we will be uploading a template for a proposal. It'll be a little bit different in a specific monitoring proposal. Monitoring projects will need to be ranked by your local lead entity, and they will be technically reviewed by our monitoring panel, the Surfboard monitoring panel, so not the review panel. So that's just a little bit of details. I know that you probably want more, and we are developing that, like I said, as we speak. So we'll be able to provide you a little bit at the end, I think, but other than that, that's what we got. Contact your region and your lead entity to find out if your region is going to even be engaging in considering monitoring projects. So regions need to decide whether or not they're going to use some of their project money for monitoring projects this year. Okay.
It'll be challenging this year for the partnership with 14, 15 lead entities to be able to figure out a process to have monitoring projects this year. Did you mention that each region can allow up to 10% of their allocation? I know in my big region, Upper Columbia, they're not going to have anything available in time this year, but they do plan on it for next year. So if there's anybody online from the Upper Columbia region, stay tuned for next year. Excuse me. Next up's eligible projects, and pretty straightforward. Planning is considered assessment feasibility designs. Most of them are in the design category. We also have acquisition, restoration, and then a combination grant can be any variety of the three above. Occasionally we have a three-way combo, but that's pretty rare. Most of the time it's acquisition restoration or acquisition design, where you're designing a restoration project on the site you're acquiring. Here's a list of items not eligible. If you ever buy any property with a home on it or a building, it's very rare that you can keep the building. A home will need to be relocated or demolished. Occasionally, you'll need to work with your grant manager regarding like an outbuilding or a small barn. You can make a case to store restoration equipment, like mowing equipment, any weed eaters, stuff like that, if you have extensive restoration on the property. But work with your grant manager. Let me go back. Indirect costs. We currently do not allow indirect costs. It has to be direct administration. We don't pay for any fish management, hatchery items, fish harvest issues. We don't effectiveness monitoring is not eligible as part of the project. We do allow compliance monitoring. Implementation monitoring, that's okay. Any acquisition sites that have ponds or side channels or off-channel areas that might be valuable sites for net pens or artificial rearing, you will need to work with us to see if that's compatible use and go through. We have a process for that. The Yakima Tribe's done that over in the Metau, so I just want to let you know about that. these are the types of planning projects we fund. So some of the interesting ones that people don't know about are the landowner willingness surveys. Most of those are related to acquisitions, but we do allow that for restoration, where you can identify a high priority reach and basically ask for money for FTE to go out and do outreach, go door to door, meeting with landowners, see if they'd be willing to do a restoration or if they're willing to sell an easement or fee simple. You can see the different levels of design we fund, feasibility, conceptual, preliminary, and final. And then we do allow data gaps to be submitted, and there's four specific criteria in Manual 18 that you have to meet. And the data gap primarily has to be identified in the recovery plan. And then you need to clearly demonstrate how you're meeting that gap and how projects will come forth out of this assessment. Is there any questions about any of those?
All quiet.
Sweet. You guys awake?
Oh, no, all quiet.
All quiet. All right. Good time to take a drink of your beverage. Design deliverables. In Appendix D, we have all of the clear requirements for all three levels of design. Please review those carefully. In fact, I highly encourage you to, if you do get a design grant with us or a restoration grant that needs design completed, to when you put out your RFP to hire a consultant or contractor, just include the appropriate appendix in that, so that whoever's bidding on the project knows what they're bidding on and what their deliverables are. You'd be surprised at how people, these deliverable criteria have been around since 07, 08, and you'd be surprised at how people still come up short. And we're not going to give you more money to finish the deliverables that you've agreed to comply with. So just something to think about. Now, the key thing about these design deliverables is it's not just drawings. It's a report. We want to see the narrative to be able to explain how you ended up selecting this certain alternative, why you're designing it this way, why you're using this material, why you've excavated this depth, and so forth. We want a narrative, not just we, us, it's collectively. The review panel wants this information to be able to review. Because it helps us have confidence in what you're proposing and what you're trying to implement. New this year, thanks to Kay Caramile, is example design reports, examples of conceptual, preliminary, and final design reports. And these are, how would you call them, Kay? They meet all of our requirements?
Yeah, these are examples of projects that meet all of our requirements. We've got examples from across the state for different types of design report, whether it be an assessment, feasibility study, conceptual design report, preliminary design report, and final reports. We should have those ready by the end of this month and up on our website soon after.
Sweet. Thank you. Here's a checklist just to guide you through the different deliverables based on the type. And this is all in Manual 18. And just, it's hard to see on the screen, but we do allow the design build construction type projects. And there's specific criteria that you need to hit. Plus, you need to work this out with your grant manager and the review panel if you're proposing this type of situation. The key things are in, you're in a low-risk area, maybe one large landowner. There's not a lot of public infrastructure in the vicinity. And then also the sponsor, and if you already have your designer under contract, you got to have experience in doing these types of projects. But again, work with your grant manager, and they'll coordinate that with the review panel through the application process. We hit some of these earlier, but real quick to add more details, if you're going the no match route for a design project, it has to be preliminary or final. You can only request up to 200 grand. And then you have to be complete, the project has to be completed in 18 months. So if you're funded December of 15, The design and all the deliverables have to be submitted to us by June of 2017, and there's no time extensions on those grants. Now, if you need a little bit more time, the site's complex, it's got unique situations, then you need to kick in the 15% match, and the big difference or the advantage there is you get 2+ years, hopefully 2.5 years to complete your design project. And time extensions are allowed if you provide match. Any questions about that? Great. Acquisition is pretty straightforward. We buy land outright where the landowner's leaving. That's the most common option, but in Eastern Washington and some areas around Western Washington, there are a lot of conservation easements where the landowner still owns the underlying fee title or may still live on the property, but they've put protective restrictions over the floodplain, the timber, wetland habitat. And we do purchase water rights. It's rare, but we do that. As long as it can be appraised and valued, we'll buy it. Acquisitions are complicated. They're time-consuming. There's a lot of paperwork, but once you get the system or the process down, it's pretty straightforward. We have a sponsor toolkit online. It's great, easy, straightforward guides, FAQs to walk you through. My preference is just give me a call for people in my areas. Just call me and get into this website, and I'll walk you through it while I'm on the phone. It's really easy. And it's a good way for us to go over things, and I can point out little nuances. But start learning this stuff early if you have an acquisition proposal. Now, we've talked about this already. You can get a waiver of retroactivity before you close on the property ahead of when the grant decision is made. This is all straightforward stuff. I guess the key take-home point is we're not into condemnation. It's all voluntary. You have to follow our appraisal process. This is all straightforward. Excuse me. We need a preliminary title report up front prior to the agreement or shortly around when the agreement's issued. And this is primarily to identify things that are incompatible with why we're buying the property. For example, if you had an easement to a local government for a dike or an easement to DNR or the Corps to dredge the creek, we're going to want to see those easements disappear if we're buying the land outright, because we don't want that impact to the habitat. So that's the value of getting the preliminary title report submitted so early. The next two items on the screen are our encumbrances, which are recorded to the title of the property, which clearly spell out how the property can be used, what the restrictions are, and what may happen if you end up violating our terms. And of course, in good RCO fashion, we have a manual for acquisitions. It spells out everything. Definitely need to have legal access to the property. That helps in the valuation process. And then we don't buy any contaminated property. You need to have it cleaned up before you secure it with our money. If you're submitting a combination project, if you're just submitting an acquisition project only, but you're proposing to have it restored, you can see that first item, it needs to be restored within 5 years of the purchase. Now, if you do have a combination project, where I was going initially, where you're buying property, then restoring it on the same site, you need to have the acquisition completed within 18 months, and then the restoration can follow after that. Again, combination projects, you have a tricky timeline, so you better be on top of your schedule if you're trying to juggle an acquisition and restoration on the same site. Plan ahead. This is a great illustration of where there was a proposed future use that is not eligible in our program. And so the sponsor, I'm assuming the sponsor did this, carved it off, that little red square. They carved off that little area from the acquisition site because in the future there was going to be this interpretive center. And then our money just went towards the green polygon. And so what would have happened if we would have had our money in the land where the interpretive center was eventually built, then we would have counted that as a conversion. It's incompatible use with salmon habitat, and you'd have to go buy replacement property valued at today's dollars and replace it, the lost habitat. So plan ahead if you have any unique future uses that are not eligible in our program. Is there a question, Mike, on your phone?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
Restoration projects, pretty straightforward. I guess the last bullet is what I'll zero in on, is if you're requesting, this isn't total project cost, this is what you're requesting from us. If it's $250,000 or greater, you have to have a preliminary design with your application. And I'm just going to run through these fairly quickly. These are all eligible restoration type projects. We put in a lot of bigger culverts, pipe arches, and bridges. We help improve irrigation diversion so that fish don't get sucked into the systems and killed. We do a lot of diversion upgrades where we're saving water, and the water gets put in the Washington Water Trust program, so it's put back in the stream for in-stream flows for fish. We do a lot of in-stream projects, large wood placement. Lately, we've been doing a lot of levee setbacks, pulling out old levees right along the rivers or right along the estuaries and setting them back to recreate habitat. Riparian habitat, we do a ton of these projects. In fact, in 2014, you'll note we have a new project type. This is our second year where previously funded surfboard riparian projects or even non-surfboard that needs maintenance because there's weeds or there's been some mortality and you need to go back in and replant. You can submit those types of grants. I have a couple of them where they have 9, 10, 11, 12 properties that they're managing within the same grant. Those are effective projects. We do a lot of these, haven't seen too many recently, but we do get into, especially on Forest Service land, DNR land, we will abandon or decommission roads. We will do maintenance of roads, cross-draining culverts, clean out ditches, remove side cast material. It's just everything you can think of to reduce sediment delivery down into the streams. Are we fun these?
Dude, Mark.
These are Mike Ramsey's favorite projects, estuary restoration, marine nearshore. We fund pretty much everything. Do we do beach nourishment, Mike?
Yes, we do.
We do. All right. Okay. And we do improve or remove tide gates. That seems to be a big thing in some areas of Puget Sound. And another manual. We have a restoration manual, manual number 5, that will spell out all these things and give you more details on prevailing wage, competitive bids, cultural resources. For those people who like to read, go to manual 5. If you want a quicker synopsis, call your grant manager. They can help give you information. Right, Kay?
We'll tell you to read manual 5.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Okay, I've already gone over this. Combos must, yeah, sweet. That's a good picture. That's Port Susan, Elizabeth.
Right.
Yeah. We've already done that. Sweet. And now, that's it. We're on to the application, and next up is Kay Caramile.
I had a couple questions. One was asking about whether design projects have a $200,000 limit. And it's actually only design-only projects, so those that do not require any match, where you're going to get 100% funding from us, those have a $200,000 limit. If you provide 15% or more match, there isn't a limit. However, just a reminder, you know, our review panel, one of their criteria is cost-benefit. And so They'll be looking at your costs for the benefit of the project to fish. So on, you know, expensive design projects, that needs to be correlative to the scale of the project. And then whether or not you can modify your applications at this time. So say you've already submitted like a letter of intent, or maybe you've already got your preliminary materials in for your site visit. Can you change those? And yes, you can. That's definitely a question for your lead-in coordinator in terms of their timing and requirements. But we anticipate, and I would imagine so does your lead entity, we anticipate that you may have changes to your application during this review time. That's one of the points of it. You might get comments from our review panel, or you might get comments from your local technical or citizens committees on how you can change or strengthen your application, and that's part of our process. So you're definitely able to make changes to your project during this period. That's it.
Thanks, Kat. I'm Kay Caramile. I'm going to be talking to you about the application materials that are required with your 2015 surfboard application. Basically, it's very similar to last year. There are a few updates, and I'll be going over those as I go through the material. So first off, I want to show you the resources that are available to you to help you understand what you need to do to apply. First and foremost is the Manual 18, Section 3. Is titled How to Apply, and it's only about 10 pages long. I highly recommend that you read that from cover to cover. It's really important for you to know what is required of you. And the reason for this is that we as grant managers have a very limited amount of time to review your applications. When it comes to your draft applications, we have a one-week time period to review them, let you know if there's anything missing or needs to be corrected, have you make the corrections, review those corrections, and then hand them on to the review panel. For your final applications, we have a two-week time period to do the same thing. And keep in mind that we have a lot of applications to go through. So if yours happens to be one of the last applications that we review, you may only have one or two days to make any necessary corrections. So it's important for you to know what you need to do to apply for a surfboard grant and to submit complete application materials. You'll find that Section 3 of Manual 18 goes over things such as how to use PRISM Online, what you need to provide for your draft application, what you need to provide for your final application, as well as tips for avoiding common mistakes. Another resource that's available to you is the RCO website. On this website, you'll be able to download our Manual 18, that's our Salmon Grant Manual. You'll also be able to download all the template application materials that you may need for your application. That includes your project proposal, your barrier inventory forms, your correction analysis form, landowner acknowledgement form, partner contribution form, etc. In addition to that, there's a couple of checklists that are available to you. We have a checklist for your draft application, as well as a checklist for your final application. And I should mention that some lead entities require more information than what we require. So it's important for you to speak with your lead entity and find out, lead entity coordinator, and find out what it is that you may need to provide in addition to our requirements. So first off, if you're thinking about applying for a surfboard grant, you're going to want to assemble your team of experts in order to help you scope your project. And equally important is you need to accurately convey that project scope in your project application. It's really important for you to have a very clear and consistent application. If we can't figure out what you're doing, if things are confusing, you're going to need to expect to get a lot of questions from us in the review panel. You don't want to tell us in one spot that you're doing the final design and another spot you're doing a preliminary design. Worst case scenario, you may have a really good project, but your application is so poorly written that you don't get funding. You want to communicate early and often with your lead entity as well as your grant manager. We're here to help you, and we're really willing to help you solve any problems early on. We'd rather do that than work with you in a last-minute crisis situation, so definitely just give us a call. Use the checklist and resources that are available to you on our website as well as through us. Last thing I just want to mention is don't wait to the last minute. All applications need to be submitted through PRISM Online. And like any computer database, it takes time to learn if you're not already familiar with it. And like any computer database, it breaks down on occasion. Usually it's down for just an hour or two, but it can be down for a day or even 2 days, which isn't very common, but you don't want to be waiting for the last minute when you've got tight deadlines.
So when you're ready to start your application, step one is to get your PRISM project number from your lead entity. As I mentioned before, all applications need to be submitted through PRISM online. However, there is a parallel database called the Habitat Work Schedule. And that database is separate from PRISM, but in order to avoid having to attach your materials to both Habitat Work Schedule and PRISM, it is important for you to form a link between the two. And the way you do that is by starting your application in the Habitat Work Schedule just by entering a minimal amount of application material, and then you finish your application in PRISM. Now, each lead entity is handling this differently. Some lead entities have you as the project applicant actually start your application in the Habitat Work Schedule, and if that's the case, they'll be handing you a set of step-by-step instructions. Some lead entities are doing that step for you. So it's important for you to speak with your lead entity and find out what you need to do. And then 3 weeks before site visits, you're going to need to submit your draft application materials. And everything I'm going to be going over is in Section 3 of Manual 18. And again, keep in mind that your local lead entity may have some additional requirements to these. So you'll need to at least complete the project details, metrics, and cost screens in PRISM. You'll need to submit a project vicinity and a site map if you're doing a restoration project, or a parcel map if you're doing an acquisition project. You'll need to submit a draft project proposal, and I'll get into this in more detail. You'll need to submit all the design information that you have available at this point in time. If you're doing a fish passage project, you're going to want to submit your barrier evaluation form, and what that form does is it helps to characterize the fish passage problem on your site. And the one thing to keep in mind with this is that many of the barriers around the state have already been evaluated, and that information is held in WDFW's website or database. And so it's important before you go and download our form and start to fill it out, you might want to contact them first, find out if your project site has already been evaluated, and perhaps you can just download the form from them. It's always good to then take it out to the site and make sure that it's current, because conditions may have changed at your site since this project was evaluated. Information on how to contact Fish and Wildlife is available in Section 3 of Manual 18, so definitely refer to that. You'll need to submit a draft detailed cost estimate, and I'll be going through that as well later on. And you'll need to, at this point, initiate your consultation with the Department of Natural Resources to find out if your project might be located on state-owned aquatic land. This is a screenshot from PRISM, and I'm not going to be going through all of PRISM to show you how to fill it out online. I think Mike will be doing that later on. But I do want to highlight that throughout your application, you're going to see instructions embedded within the within PRISM online. This right here is regarding your project description. You'll see that there's actually a bulleted list of items that need to be included in your project description, and you need to address all of those. If you don't address them, we're going to be asking you to revise your project description in order to address them. These bullets basically ask you to answer the questions of who, what, where, and why you're doing your project. Another thing to keep in mind with your project description is that it's intended to clearly and completely summarize your project. If you are, things we've been reminded recently this morning of, is it's important that no matter, whatever you plan on doing as far as every element of your project should be reflected in your project description. And so if you're choosing work types that talk about riparian and in-stream work, you need to make sure that all of those items are addressed in your project description as well. And vice versa, if you talk about it in your project description, you need to make sure you check off those work types as well. This is an example project description, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I did want to just read the first paragraph. The Jones nonprofit will acquire approximately 20 acres adjacent to Liquid Creek, east of Highway 11013 in Bee County. The parcel includes critical riparian wetland and in-stream habitats on 10 acres and 10 acres of adjacent upland. 5 of the riparian acres will be restored by planting native vegetation. These habitats support Endangered Species Act listed anadromous fish, including coho, summer and fall chinook, chum, and steelhead. Well, this is a complete project description in that it answers the who, the Jones nonprofit, What are they doing? They're acquiring approximately 20 acres, and 5 of those acres are going to be restored. Where is the project located? On Liquid Creek. And why are they doing this project? The project's being done to support endangered species listed fish. It builds upon the land trust adjacent land holdings, and it's being done to protect functioning habitat. When it comes to your vicinity map, the key thing with this is to make sure you're zoomed out far enough so that the nearby towns and major roadways are identified. The purpose of your vicinity map is to help people locate your project. So if you're zoomed in too close to the site, it doesn't enable anyone to do that. Your restoration site map, that needs to be able to clearly show the project boundaries and where each activity is going to be occurring within your project site. I don't have an example of a parcel map here, but Mark's already shared several of those with you during his presentation. A draft project proposal is required to be attached to your draft application, and I'm going to spend some time here. Recently, I was asked, why do we need to submit a project proposal? We've already answered these questions in PRISM. Isn't this just redundant? And the two are actually quite different. We really do strive to minimize any redundancy that are in the two different items. But keep in mind that your PRISM application really talks about your project in a broad sense, and it documents what you plan on doing. It does not talk about why you plan on doing it. Your project proposal really gives the why, and it provides a lot more details, the ins and outs, nitty-gritty details of what you plan on doing. We have 3 different project proposals to choose from, so you want to make sure that you choose the best fit. One of these is for restoration projects, acquisition projects, or for combination restoration and acquisition. One is for planning projects or combination planning and acquisition. And one is for fish passage barrier inventory projects. So it's really important to choose the right one because the questions are different in each of these. If you are proposing to do a final design for a restoration project, you're going to be filling out the planning project proposal, not the restoration proposal, because your final deliverable is the project design. Your project proposal should be 10 pages max. That does exclude your supplemental questions, and I do want to highlight the fact that we've kind of designed the proposal so that you can delete all of the italicized text in order to shorten up your proposal. That italicized text is meant to kind of, you'll see on the project questions that you'll see a bolded section, then an italicized text. The italicized text was just meant to help to guide you in how to respond to the question, so you can delete that as you actually enter your response. This will really help to shorten up the proposal. And keep in mind that your proposal is your sales pitch. This is your chance to sell your project. Why is your project so important to do? Why is it so important to do in this particular location? So you need to treat it that way. To me, your project proposal is really the most important part of your entire application. Mark has a question.
No, I just have a comment. You don't have to use the full 10 pages in your response. You can use 5 or 4. That would be sweet. That's just the max.
So what's new in the project proposal this year? Well, almost every year we update the project proposal. We try to delete questions that are no longer relevant, delete questions that might be redundant. This year we did that. You'll see a lot of reorganization. We've consolidated some questions. We did add a new question, and this may be some of the redundancy that people talk about. But we did add a brief project summary right at the beginning of your project proposal, but that's really meant to be 1, 2, 3 sentences tops. This is just meant to say so-and-so, you know, the Walla Walla Conservation District is planning to do final designs on 3 mile of restoration for the Walla Walla River near Walla Walla, Washington. So, I mean, it's just meant to be a real basic statement, and the reason we asked you to do this is that oftentimes the reviewers are going out on site with just your project proposal in hand. They're not bringing all of your entire PRISM application with them. And so having this just really brief statement helps to kind of set the stage as they read the rest of your project proposal. The problem statement, you'll see that that's been reorganized and broken up a little bit into a few different pieces in order to tease out some information. And the thing to remember in your problem statement is that, you know, again, this is your chance to sell your project. you want your problem statement to really be specific to your project site. You don't want it to be this generic problem statement that you could cut and paste into any application. You really want it to be site specific. And for example, if you're doing a riparian restoration project, you don't want to just say, well, I'm doing this riparian restoration project because riparian is listed as a limiting factor in my watershed. That really doesn't tell us much. Basically, riparian is a limiting factor in almost every watershed in the state. And so it doesn't really answer the question about, you know, why you're doing this particular project at this location. Information that would be more helpful is if you can talk about if the project site's been known to be exceeding temperature standards. Is this where the fish are rearing? Is the temperature being exceeded during this critical time period when the fish are present? Have you done some sort of watershed analysis and determined that this particular reach is an important one for you to be focusing on? All of that is really good information to include in your problem statement. Another thing new in the project proposals this year is that we've embedded some goals, example goals and objectives in the project proposal. We have always asked you to state your project goals and objectives, but in the past we've just referred you to the Stream Habitat Restoration Guidelines to learn what a goal and objective is and how to respond to the question. We found that that just didn't work. Probably 90% of you didn't answer the question in the way in which it was intended. And so what we've done differently this year is we've actually embedded examples right into the project proposal. Something to keep in mind when it talks about a project goal, your goal is not what you're doing, it's why you're doing it. For example, your goal is not to set back 5 miles of levee along the Puyallup River. Your goal is to reconnect disconnected floodplain and off-channel habitat, or to restore riparian connectivity and function. The setting back of the levee is just the tool you're using to achieve that goal. So that's really the distinction to make. Your goals and objectives answer the why, not the what you're doing. For the objectives, I'm just going to read this section. Objectives support and refine your goals, breaking them down into smaller steps. Objectives are specific quantifiable actions your project will complete to achieve your stated goal. Each objective should be SMART, quote unquote, specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and time-bound. And so there's several examples given here, and your objectives, you may have multiple objectives for each goal, but an example for an acquisition project, for instance, is to acquire fee simple titled or permanent conservation easements on at least 20 acres of intact riparian forest land in the Tier 1 reach of Finney Creek by 2018. You know, this responds to all of the criteria that are listed above. Your objectives, you're not held to those. It's not that you're going to be considered, your project will be a failure if you're not meeting them, but it's your way of articulating what it is you're trying to achieve out there, and then as you develop your project design, you can make sure that that design is working towards meeting those objectives. Yeah.
Okay, we had a question about how sponsors should characterize and craft proposals if their project is a phase of a larger project. So, for example, a design grant for a future restoration or an acquisition for future restoration. And I think this is an important question, and it echoes back to what Kay mentioned in terms of in PRISM, when you're selecting your work types and metrics, be sure that they focus specifically on what you're going to achieve in this phase, what you're going to achieve with this funding and match that you're showing. And make sure you're clearly identifying in your description what you're going to do with this phase. There are some questions in the project proposal that talk about how does your project fit into a larger phased project. And you can discuss it there. You can also discuss it in your description if you'd like, but be sure that you are clear what you're going to achieve with this funding. So I think it's important to put your project in context. It gives the reviewers and your citizens committees, you know, that greater picture of what's going on, of what your goals are, but be sure that it's also clear what you're going to do with this project.
Thanks. So for project designs at this point, I recommend giving everything you've got at this point. If you've got final designs, a final design report, construction specifications, attach them all to PRISM. Don't hold back. Don't just give us a summary page. Give us everything. The review panel finds these very helpful in understanding what it is you plan on doing and why you plan on doing it. If you're not that far along, that's okay. This is just your draft application. Maybe you've just got a concept at this point. By all means, just, you know, mark up an aerial photograph. You know, develop just sketches. You can have some example photographs of similar projects you've done elsewhere. It doesn't have to be computer generated. It can be done in pencil and crayon. It really doesn't matter. The important thing is that you are very clear and that we can understand exactly what it is you're proposing to do. This gets into what Kat was just talking about. It's important to illustrate your phases. If your project is part of a phase project, you know, show all the different phases of the project and make sure it's very understandable which phase is being applied for at this point in time. Detailed cost estimates. I'm going to spend some time here and we're going to show you. We do have a new template spreadsheet that we can use that we'll get to in a minute. Some people ask also, you know, why do we do a detailed cost estimate? The information you provide in PRISM is very large scale. It doesn't provide any detail whatsoever regarding how you came up with these big numbers. And so your detailed cost estimate is meant to explain, you know, where you came up with this request. If you're doing a restoration project, you want to make sure that that cost estimate is broken up into your various materials, your labor, your equipment, your design costs. If you're doing an acquisition project, it needs to be broken up between your land, your appraisals, review appraisals, etc. You want to spell it all out. What you don't want to do is just say consultant, $200,000. That really doesn't explain anything to us. You want to break that down. What is the consultant doing? Well, they're doing a LIDAR survey, and they're doing a hydraulic analysis, and they're doing a preliminary design. You want to break it all up so that we understand how you came up with these costs. These costs are used by the review panel. They go through everything to make sure that you've considered everything you should be considering. Perhaps you've forgotten something that they're going to point out. They're also going to want to look at your costs to determine, you know, do they seem reasonable? You don't want to cut yourself short. Cost increases are sometimes available, but you can't count on them. So you want to make sure, especially if your project is being proposed now, but you won't actually be going to construction for another, you know, 2 or 3 years, you want to make sure you factor in inflation in there, taxes, some sort of contingency. And when it comes to contingency, you can't have a separate line item that just says contingency. You really need to embed that through the other, throughout the rest of the line items in your estimate. I know the total ends up being the same, but the reason we don't allow a separate line item for contingency is twofold. One is that you don't know what that contingency is associated with. Is that contingency just associated with a single line item? Is that where the uncertainty lies, or is it really spread throughout? And another reason for not having contingency as a separate line item is really public perception. If you tie up a lot of money in just something kind of nebulous, such as contingency, it really doesn't look good on the bottom line. And the last thing I want to mention as far as your draft cost estimates is you want to make sure that the total at the bottom of your cost estimate matches your total in PRISM. And if it doesn't, you need to explain why. When we look at your cost estimate, if the two don't match, we're going to be asking you questions. Did you perhaps forget something? Maybe you've attached the wrong estimate. But you might have very good reasons on why the two don't match. Maybe that you've got a $1.5 million project and you're only asking Surfboard to pay for $200,000. Well, you don't want to have to claim $1.3 million in match, and that's totally fine. We're okay with you doing that. But the important thing is to let us know, and there's a couple ways of doing that. One, you can have a separate part of your spreadsheet that actually says, you know, match this not included in your PRISM budget, and so you can show it that way. Another way is to show your full budget, but then just include a note, such as shown here. For the purpose of the Surfboard grant application, the total project cost is a subset of the above cost and is listed as such and such, which includes match and the surfboard grant. Any actual costs exceeding this total will be covered through non-surfboard funds but will not be considered match. This explains things, and this is all we're looking for. One thing that I find difficult to explain, so I'll give it my best shot, and if you've got questions, definitely talk to your grant manager, read our manuals. RCO does set certain limits on certain types of costs. So if you are doing an acquisition project, you are limited to your administrative costs can only be a maximum of 5% of your acquisition costs. So what that means is your acquisition costs are broken down into land costs. That's your actual purchase of the land. Incidental costs, which refers to things such as appraisals, review appraisals, title reports, closing costs, taxes, etc. And then administrative costs. And those administrative costs include things such as your time negotiating with the landowners or filling out final reports and progress reports and doing billings. Manual 3 of our acquisition manual gives a full list of things that are included as acquisition administrative costs. But the thing to remember is that in your application and when you bill us later on after being funded, the most administrative costs you can charge is 5% of the land plus incidental costs of your project. That is probably confusing, but again, speak with us and we can try to work with you on that. Similarly, if you're doing a restoration project, you're limited to how much A&E you can charge us. Your A&E refers to your architecture, engineering, and administrative costs. Again, that type of thing would be your design costs, your time associated with doing billings, progress reporting, final reporting, etc. And so typically your A&E costs run about 20% of your construction costs. The most RCO allows you to charge is 30% of your construction costs. So that means if you have a construction project that's going to cost $100,000 to build, the most A&E you can charge to the grant is $30,000 for a total project cost of $130,000. As I mentioned before, we do have a new template cost estimate spreadsheet that was developed this year, and I'm going to turn over to Kat, and she's going to show you how to use the spreadsheet. Can you try to get to it?
Hey guys, so you can find this template on our website. So manual 18, so where we're at, you go to our website, you can click on documents, grant manuals by number or grant application materials, scroll down to 18. Here's all your application, your proposals, and then there's the cost estimate spreadsheet, which you can click on and it'll download an Excel spreadsheet you can fill out. It's not protected, so just be aware of that, which could be great for you. You might want to change it. It might be that you also alter some formulas that we've embedded. So just be aware that there are formulas embedded in it. This is something that we developed with the template from the Lower Columbia region. We also looked at Yakima's. Those were the two areas that have templates that they use. And so some of you who have applied in the past may have gotten some feedback from the review panel or from your lead entities that your cost estimates aren't showing enough detail or showing too much detail, or so we wanted to provide an example of or a template that you could use that might provide just enough. That is what the review panel is looking for. We'll see if that's the truth with this example, but that's the goal of this. So when you open it up, there's some instructions. I'm not going to go through everything. There's links to different manuals. You can enter in your project name, your surfboard number, and your sponsor here, and unless you delete the links, it will show up on the different tabs, which you'll fill out. So here's the acquisition template, the design template, the restoration template. if you have a restoration project, enter your design costs on your restoration template, not on the design tab. The design tab is the template for design only projects or assessments. Then if you're doing a combo, you're going to fill out the different elements. So if you're doing an acquisition restoration, you'll fill out an acquisition one and a restoration one, and then they will total on the total page. So let's just look through this restoration one. Acquisition cost templates are not required to have this separate attachment because our metrics and in Prism Online require quite a bit of detail. So you'll notice on this acquisition one, there's drop downs for property costs. These are the same things we ask you for in Prism Online, and similarly for incidentals. I got this list of incidentals from Prism Online. So these are the things you have to select as work types or what do we call them? work types. In Prism Online. So you have to actually provide this level of information in Prism Online for acquisition projects. However, you might have a really complicated acquisition project. You might have multiple properties, so you know you might want to use this. So we left it here for you to use, or your tag or your review panel might ask you for this. So that's why we've created it. But let's hit the restoration one. So we're asking for a category and a description of that category. So the category are things that are eligible costs from the restoration manual. So these are things that we've identified as eligible construction costs. So just general construction, construction labor, supervision, cultural resources, demo, site prep, permits, project signs, surveys, et cetera, and good old other. We're asking you to select one of these and then further describe it in task description. Since construction is kind of a broad thing, go into a little more detail about what that might be. There's a quantity column, and then there's a rate, and they will hopefully work to follow through. So there you go. One at $40, $40 of the overall budget. And then you want to break down how much of that is going to be your grant request and how much is going to be match that you're going to put in Prism or match that you're not reporting in Prism. So this gets to what Kay was talking about earlier in terms of, you know, you have a lot more match, but you're not putting it all in Prism. You can break it up into these two columns here as long as they add up to this total amount. We left a column for source and type for you to fill out if you'd like to. There are some, we've broken it into construction costs and also into A&E, so they're separate just like they would be. The A&E are, these are things that are general types of A&E that we see, so data collection, different, you know, assessments that you have to do, geologic, hydraulic, et cetera, different types of assessments, a conceptual design task, preliminary design task, final design, other, or administrative, things like project management, billing, et cetera. So again, select one of these, then give us a little bit more description. There's the quantity and the rate columns there. And then down here, there's when you start building your budget, it will identify how much is your maximum A&E allowed. So there's a little formula here that's built in based on what you're putting into your construction costs. So that 30% of your construction costs should be built in there. So there's a lot of detail on this. I would play around with it and ask your grant manager if you have questions or run into questions. If you mess up the formulas, you can download a new one online and work from there. We could also make one that's protected if you guys would like that. If we get enough feedback that you want one that's protected that you can't change, we could do that. So this really is an experiment this year, and again, it's not required. It's just a template. You can use one that you're comfortable with, that you've had success with, or you can use one that your lead entity asks you to use also. So I don't know if anyone else has any other comments in the room on it, but
Actually, we did protect this one, but no password on it. So if you want to play with it, you can go into the review tab at the top and just click unprotect.
Okay.
And it will allow you to unlock it without a password required.
Cool.
That's for those sponsors who don't know how to work in Excel and don't realize they can delete formulas.
Right, right. Yeah.
So we made it easy in case you do want to.
Great. Good. Thanks. And yeah, these little red tabs here give you a little bit more information about what might be like little notes whenever you see a little red tab. And I think those are left over from Lower Columbia. I may not have edited those. But it describes kind of, I think they're applicable because we pretty much took Lower Columbia. So if you're in Lower Columbia, continue to use theirs if that's what they want you to use.
Thanks, Kat.
Yeah.
Thanks, Kat. I'm just going to wrap up the draft application requirements and move on to the final application requirements. The last thing I'm going to cover with your draft application is that now's the time for you to start your consultation with the Department of Natural Resources to determine if your project may be located on state-owned aquatic land. You may think that you're working on private property, and you are, but if you're working between the ordinary high water marks of your stream, you may actually also be working on state-owned aquatic land. There's no way to tell. There's no maps that are available for you to look at. What you need to do is call Department of Natural Resources. We have the phone numbers. Links are on our Section 3 of Manual 18. Definitely contact them. And the reason this is important is that it's not that they're going to prevent you from doing the project, but they're just one more landowner that you need to work with. You're going to need to get a landowner acknowledgement form for them with your final application. And as you develop your project designs, you're going to need to work with them at that time because you don't want to have any surprises at the end if they have concerns over what you're proposing. So after you submit your draft application, we grant managers will review your application. We're going to submit it to the review panel. They're going to review your application. We're going to go out on site. And then approximately 2 weeks after site visits, you'll receive some comments from the review panel. You may also receive some comments from the local technical team as well. And it's going to be important for you to address those comments, consider them seriously, and address them in your final application. So final applications are due in August to the RCO. However, your local lead entity may have an earlier deadline, so talk with them to find out what their deadlines are. You'll need to complete the PRISM application if you haven't done so already, making sure that you update it as needed. And you'll need to complete all the attachments that are required. There are several more attachments required for your final application than were required for your draft application. So it's important for you to know what those are and get them all attached. Your final attachments include two project photos. These need to be in JPEG format. And if they're not in JPEG format, PRISM is going to kick them out and will not accept your application. You need to include a landowner acknowledgement form, as Mark had talked about earlier. You need a landowner acknowledgement form if you're working on property that is not owned by you as the project sponsor. You need to submit your final project proposal, your final detailed cost estimate. The partnership contribution form is required if you're a state agency, because state agencies require a local partner. If you are not a state agency, you may also want to use a partner contribution form to document third-party match, but this isn't required. An example might be if the U.S. Forest Service is going to be donating $40,000 in wood material for your project. You might want to document that in writing through a partnership contribution form and attach that in PRISM. During your draft application, you would have submitted a barrier evaluation form if you were doing a fish passage project. For your final application, you'll need to submit a barrier correction analysis form. That is if you already have your design in hand. You'll need to submit an area of potential effect map. That allows us to do culture resource consultation. I'll be discussing that more in a moment. You'll need to submit any updated design information that you have at this point. You know, anything more that you didn't have at the time of your draft application. Keeping in mind, as Mark had mentioned earlier, that preliminary designs are required if you're requesting $250,000 or more from Surf Board. and by preliminary design, that means a permit-ready design. That does not mean a conceptual-level design. It means permit-level. If you're not going to have a preliminary design available for your final application, it's important for you to talk to your local, to your grant manager now, because it may be that you need to rescope your project to be a design-only grant this year and submit for construction funds in a future round. If you've been previously funded by Surfboard to have design deliverables and now you're applying to Surfboard for construction, it's important that you provide the design deliverables from your prior phase, or at least a preliminary design. If you had been contracted to do a final design previously, at least have a preliminary design. The reason behind is that, you know, you presumably went for a design grant for a reason, because you needed time to develop your designs, figure out what it is you're going to be doing and how much it's going to cost. And so you don't want to go to construction not having figured that out yet. If your project is located in an intensively monitored watershed, you're going to need to get a certification from that local lead entity that certifies that your project will not be detrimental to the monitoring work going on in that watershed. That certification will typically take the form of a letter or an email, and just attach that in PRISM. And then if there's anything else you wanted to attach, if there's any graphs or references, letters of support, things like that, you can attach them in PRISM as well. So Mark already talked about the landowner acknowledgement form to some degree. A landowner acknowledgement form, if you're working on property that you do not own, a landowner acknowledgement form is required from every property that you're going to be working on. So if you're doing a restoration project or a design project on one or more properties that you do not own, you need a landowner acknowledgement form from every property owner, not just one or two, from all of them. If you're doing an acquisition project, you need to have a landowner acknowledgement form from the priority parcels that you're targeting. You do not need them for second and third priority parcels, but definitely for the priority parcels. If you're doing a general assessment over, you know, several miles of stream, you do not need a landowner acknowledgement form, because you're just not tied to that project as closely, to that property as closely. All of this is discussed in Section 3 of Manual 18, and you should refer to that section of the manual. Again, the landowner acknowledgement form is not the same as a landowner agreement. All your acknowledgement form does is it's signed by the landowner and acknowledges that you are applying for funding for a project that may affect their property. It does not commit them to the project itself. Your final project proposal is due with your final application. Again, you'll likely need to be doing any updates in order to address review panel comments that you've received. The important thing to note is that any changes you make to your proposal between the draft and the final application need to be made using the track changes feature in Word. If you don't know how to use that, talk to your grant manager. We can tell you how to do it. It's just two clicks of the button on your computer. It's important to have everything in track changes, because it really helps the reviewers to hone in on what the changes are between your draft and your final application. It helps to avoid them having to reread your entire application and look to see if there were any changes. So please do this. If you forget to turn on track changes, let us know, because as long as we have a copy of your original project proposal, we can do a compare documents and get it to generate all the changes and track changes. So the last thing you want to do is attach your project proposal without track changes. You want to just talk to us first and get it in track changes. At the end of the project proposal, you're going to see a section that's for you to respond to site visit comments. You have to fill in this section with your final project proposal. You may have updated your entire proposal and your entire application to address comments, but you also have to fill out this section. And in this section, you can mention that, okay, I addressed this particular comment in section 4 of the project proposal, or you can answer and respond directly to the review panel right here. So there's the section you're filling out right now is the response to site visit comments. The other section you see here, response to post-application comments, comes later. So once you submit your final application, the review panel is going to review that final application, and they're either going to clear your project or else they're going to have some additional comments and questions. And if they do have additional comments and questions, you'll respond to those in this location right here in your project proposal. Last year, we started requiring an area of potential effect map to be attached in PRISM with your final application. This is to help us with our cultural resources review of your project. There's a couple of important things to note on here. Your area potential effect map has to show the section number, as in section township range. The section numbers need to be visible in the map that you provide. It also needs to show all areas of ground disturbance. This includes planting, access, and staging areas. That is all considered to be ground disturbance. And so it may be that you can submit one map that has it all, but in such as a case like this, you may need to submit two maps in one document, one that zoomed out far enough to see section numbers and one that zoomed in close enough to see the actual ground disturbance locations. And while we're on the subject of cultural resources, it's important to note that throughout PRISM, there are some questions within the PRISM application itself that are for our cultural resource consultation. It's important to respond to every question accurately and clearly. Don't feel like, oh, I've already talked about this someplace else. It's important to respond to each question as you come to it. And make a note that this year we have updated several of the questions in PRISM that refer to cultural resources in order to tease out some more detailed information from you guys. A couple of final checks when you're done with your application. First thing you're going to want to do is go to the Submit Application tab at the bottom of your PRISM Online screen. And when you get there, click on the Check Application for Errors. When you do that, it's going to review your entire application and look for missing information. It doesn't evaluate how well you answered your questions. That's going to be done by us in the review panel, but it will check to make sure that you've answered everything. And so if you have a green check mark, that means you're good to go. Any red exclamation marks, such as right here, means that something needs to be done. And so you can click on that, and that'll provide further guidance as far as what you need to do to correct that error. And some lead entities do not allow project sponsors to submit their applications. They do it for them. But even if that's the case, you still need to check your application for errors. Otherwise, your lead entity coordinator is going to find it at the very last minute as they go to submit your application and run into problems. The other thing to do is you need to use the resources that are available to you. We have these application checklists. These are reference your application attachments. Even though PRISM has accepted your application does not mean it's complete. If you haven't submitted all of your attachments, your project application is not complete. PRISM only checks for a certain attachments. It's not programmed to check for all required attachments. So definitely use your checklists. Make sure that you've got everything you need. And once you're done, you go back to that Submit Application tab, check on the certification box, and submit your application by the lead entity deadline. And again, keep in mind that your lead entity deadline may be sooner than August 14th because the lead entities need time to review and rank your final projects. Thank you.
Okay, Mark's going to get a few more crackers. You want to rattle the bag before we start here. My name is Elizabeth Butler. I'm going to go over some of the project expectations. And these are some things that we have highlighted because they've caused some of your colleagues in past grant rounds some challenges. So we want you to be thinking ahead. So we want to talk about getting your budget right so that you'll have enough money to implement your project according to our requirements. So I don't have a lot of time today to go over the details. So I want to point you again, as Mark and Kay have, to our manuals, Manual 3 for acquisition projects, Manual 5 for restoration projects. Our project agreement we have, a sample is actually a part of our Manual 7, long-term obligations. And there's also a way to preview something in PRISM once you're funded. We have progress reporting twice a year and a final report. So as you're estimating your admin and A&E costs, you want to make sure you're planning for the time it takes to do the grant management work. There are land control and tenure requirements. So make sure you're putting time into negotiating those landowner agreements and the stewardship plans. And then there are the follow through on the cultural resources consultation and the permit compliance that was alluded to earlier. So also, if you want to get a preview, if you haven't received a surfboard grant before, we do have a successful applicant workshop that is recorded and online as some resources. So if you want to get a view into 2016, if you are successful about what's going to be required for billing and that sort of thing, we have a new e-billing module that's going to be coming your way in the next few weeks. So there's a lot of things that take time to do to be successful, and we want to make sure you're calculating that when you're putting your cost estimate together. So Kay talked about the cultural resources. We have this area of potential effect. And what we do is we initiate a consultation once we have the board has approved our grant. So that's something that starts towards the end of December this year. But over the past couple years, I've had quite a few projects that have incurred some significant cultural resources expenses, both for the consultation and for mitigation. So it makes sense. We're working on river shorelines and on the edge of the Salish Sea. People have lived here for thousands of years. And so we happen to find shell middens and culturally modified trees and fish camps and other archaeological resources that persist today on our landscape. The sites are fragile and non-renewable cultural resources, and they contain valuable information about the people who lived here before us. So there are laws, state and federal, that protect them. Or we also have had some projects that have historic farmsteads or homesteads or railroad structures. So any structure that's over 50 years old that you're planning to remove or potentially acquire, we do have to consult on that as well. So there's a couple of things that we've been evolving as an agency on cultural resources consultation. If you have a federal nexus, you're getting a core permit for your restoration project, you're going to be getting this consultation covered through the Section 106 when the Corps is managing your permit review. And the Section 106 usually requires a cultural resources assessment, and that can be a significant cost. So you're going to want to make sure you've budgeted for that. I've seen them as high as $9,000, but you'd want to work with an consultant to try to get an estimate that will be appropriate for your site. If you are coming in for a design project and you have some ground disturbing activities in advance of starting your Section 106 consultation with the Corps, like you know you're going to have to get a Corps permit, but you're just doing preliminary or final design, you're going to be doing potentially ground disturbance out of sequence for the consultation. And some of our sponsors have actually started to have archaeologists out on site to monitor the ground disturbing activities and incorporate the observations into your assessment so that you can present them to the Corps with a little more information. So it doesn't mean we necessarily have to consult twice. We have an agreement with DAP and the tribes that we can, as long as we're reflecting what's there in our assessment, we can move forward out of sequence. But a lot of our projects don't need a core permit. You're doing riparian restoration, or maybe you're doing an acquisition and you're going to do some demolition of a house that's less than 50 years old, or a trailer, or maybe some curbs from an old mobile home park that all the homes are removed from. Those ground disturbing activities then would be subject to the governor's executive order 0505. And so we would initiate consultation with the Department of Archaeology and Historic Preservation and the tribal governments. And that can take a lot of time as well, depending on what is determined to be the impacts. So you're going to want to make sure you're budgeting time for consultation and possibly an assessment. And then if you find out that there is impact from your restoration, then there's going to be a memorandum of agreement and a mitigation negotiation. And so we've had some projects with mitigation that's upward of $300,000 in order to complete restoration where there was a historic or archaeological fish camp. So these things can be significant, and it's one of the benefits of actually doing your design work first in a separate grant, because you can nail down a lot of these details through your design process and permitting. So this really pertains to projects that do have ground disturbing activities. If you don't have ground disturbing activities, I understand you still will need to provide an APE, but there's not going to be any impacts. The other thing we want to make sure is that you've got your pre-agreement deliverables outlined. These were things that were new a few years ago, so we do tend to remind people again. These land certification forms, it's important to talk to your landowners that you're partnering with a private landowner. You're going to want to make sure that you're not going to be impacting access easements. Maybe neighbors have access on right-of-way through this property and you were planning to have the creek moved into that driveway or something. You're going to want to go over the details of their site, their property, and sometimes that means seeing if you can't get a look at the title report to see if there are any encumbrances on title that would impact the ability to do restoration. But a lot of times it's just a conversation. And then for acquisition projects, the first step, as every good acquisition professional knows, is to check title and make sure that you really do want to buy this property. There isn't anything hanging out, any encumbrances that would get in the way of your project success. If the landowner's underwater and he owes more on the property than what the appraisal will show, it's probably not going to be a deal you can put together because we have limits on what we can pay for property. So talk to your grant manager if you have any questions about this, but all these checklists are available on our website. So we talked a little bit about eligible pre-agreement costs. We're going to hit them again. Waiver of retroactivity is really critical if you're trying to acquire land before you have an agreement. Just work with your grant manager. It doesn't mean that you'll get a grant, and it also means that you still have to follow our acquisition policies. But having this little letter from us with a waiver number means that you do close before you have an agreement, then it's potentially eligible for match or reimbursement. And then you have your design costs and your control and tenure project elements. And sometimes if you have match that needs to be expended before you have an agreement, you can acquire some of the materials you need for your restoration as a way to kind of get money in the deal before it technically would be eligible. Because we do not allow construction to begin before we have a project agreement. We cannot count any construction that starts before your agreement date unless it is after the agreement date. So hold off on any ground disturbing activities. And if you do have some match that's going to be expiring before you have an agreement, think about whether you can buy some of your materials now. Maybe you can get a bridge and hold it until next summer. Anything else, you guys that have been here for a while? Okay. That's it. Technical assistance. Boy, I got off easy this year.
Goodness. Hi, everybody. This is Alice Rubin. I see that we're getting close to our 3 o'clock hour. I hope that you all can stay because we're going to be going through PRISM very quick after this section, which will be very quick. So if you need a little help and want to see what PRISM looks like, I hope that you can stay with us after we go through this technical assistance section.
We can see when they sign off, right? So we can
count
that for future.
So we're monitoring you. We're watching you. So I'm going to go through this really quickly. We have some technical documents and resources that you can use if you need a little extra help or suggestions as you're putting your project together. First is our stream habitat restoration guidelines, but the stream habitat restoration guidelines. We also refer to these as SHRUG, so you might hear us say, well, have you looked in SHRUG? It's a pretty robust document that can give some suggestions if you're not exactly sure how to approach your potential restoration project. It has a lot of ideas on stream restoration, beaver reintroduction, all sorts of good stuff. It was updated in 2012, and on this page you can see a list of what changed, and also there's a link. Oh, and there's also some good information, as Kay mentioned, on goals and objectives. If you're still having trouble with putting those together in your application, I highly recommend that you reference the SHRUG. Going along with SHRUG are also water crossing guidelines. So if you're working on culverts or bridges or that sort of project, this is also a good reference to help you design and think about your project.
new last year were the Marine Shoreline Design Guidelines. That this is really mostly for Puget Sound, or it was designed using Puget Sound. I'm sure if you have marine shorelines outside of Puget Sound that there are some good suggestions to get you thinking along those lines, but really it's mostly designed, it is designed for Puget Sound projects. Again, Puget Sound projects, did I say that enough times? Mm-hmm. We've got bulkhead removal in bold here. If you've got a project like that, I'm sure that there's some good suggestions here on how to approach those types of projects in that kind of environment. Some other guidelines that most folks don't realize exist are fishway guidelines and the fish protection screen guidelines. You can see that they were, they're still in draft form. They were never finalized, but there's still a lot of useful information available in these guidelines to help you if you have those sorts of projects. They were written in 2000, but that doesn't mean there still isn't helpful information that you can use for those projects if you have these types of projects. There's also some really good human resources available to you if you need help with biological technical assistance. As you can see, they're pretty much all available through Department of Fish and Wildlife. I apologize for not having the link, but I'm sure if you go to the Fish and Wildlife website or contact your lead entity, they will have information on how to contact these folks in your area. The area habitat biologists issue permits and are familiar with your area. The area fish biologists monitor fish populations. A lot of times you'll get questions about fish populations in your project area, so they're a great resource. And the area wildlife biologists monitor other wildlife populations in the area. So if you're looking for that kind of help, I really suggest that you reach out and talk to your folks at DFW because they're very knowledgeable about what's going on in your area regarding that information. And here's just a couple of websites for you for these types of projects, fish screening, fish passage, and passage barrier and surface water diversion screening assessment and prioritization manual. Kay referred to that earlier when she was talking to barrier assessments. And some more for your permit assistance. Permits are a big part of being able to move forward with your restoration projects, and it's sometimes an onerous process. So there's a lot of information out there to help you through the ORA agency, which is through the governor's office. So they have a hotline that you can call if you're not sure where to begin, and they'll help walk you through your permitting process based on your project type. So it's a really great resource if you haven't gone through permitting before or you're not sure which permits you might need. I highly suggest you go to their website or call and get assistance with a real human person. And again, SHRUG has some good resources in their appendix. And if you would like some ESA consultation information, Randy McIntosh from NOAA Fisheries is a great resource, and he's happy to help you. We've had help from him in the past. So finding application information, I think this is going into PRISM. it looks like it's going into PRISM without transition. So Mike, do you want to do this, or we can just... Oh, look, this is us. So here are your grant managers as we transition in. Sorry, a little unorganized here. And here are your regional and lead entity areas if you're not sure who your project manager is. Here at RCO, this outlines who we are, what areas we cover. Oh, here we go. Now we're in PRISM Online. Sorry about that. Now on to Mike.
Sorry. All right, everybody. It's probably a good time to stretch while we load up PRISM here.
And just for those of you that are good with PRISM, just now is a good time to sign off. Our workshop was planned from 1 to 3, so for those of for those of you that can stay and learn a little bit more about PRISM or have a desire to go ahead and stay on and tune in. Otherwise, if you need to check out, we'll be posting this to the website so you can come back at a later date and check this out and learn a little bit more about how to use our PRISM application online. So thank you so much for attending and spending time with us today. I know it's a lot of overwhelming information, but we hope that it was useful. So again, thanks for coming. If you need to leave and if you can stay a little longer, Mike will spend probably just a few minutes here going through the PRISM application online.
All right. We're in the test environment, but this looks exactly the same as what you'll see in the real environment. But there's a couple ways. Now, I'm assuming that you've gotten your projects through Habitat Work Schedule or you've already gotten your project number. I created a project today right here. Actually, I created it last week, but for today. Or you can, if you know your project number, you can enter it in over here. So it's 15-1025, enter.
You can also put the name in.
Yeah, you can put the name. Right. Is it going?
Yeah.
And then you get to watch the spinning wheel. Okay, so what Kay showed you was very good, but now we're in the real environment and you don't see as many icons here or items. And they'll self-populate as you keep entering data. So now, I think I will just leave that us as a sponsor. But you'll need to enter your name there, whatever organization you're from, and a secondary sponsor if you need to do that. These are typically not assigned, so. This is a screen you don't need to worry a lot about. Just make sure you are in there as the sponsor.
If you add a secondary sponsor, they become a signatory to the agreement. So know that,
right.
Generally.
Generally they do. It doesn't self-populate, though.
Yeah, but they're assumed to be a signatory.
Right. So now we're on the contacts page, and we want to add a contact. And let's see, I'll do... And I'm just doing it by names here. And, John, I didn't want to do that. And then Kevin Long is one of my prominent sponsors. So, and it'll always show up here as the project contact. I do want to keep him as that, but if you wanted to change that, you wanted to enter your lead entity contact or in the other, your billing person, somebody in your organization that needs to get the agreement, you can put that there. But I'm going to leave that there, and I'm just going to keep going. I'm going to go to next. I'm not going to save a bunch here and hopefully not pay the price for it. But
it saves automatically.
Yeah, it's saving anyway. So now you probably won't get this full list. Well, actually, you probably will get this full list, except for ESRP is not open right now. All these other programs that are within my jurisdiction, I guess, are available. But you should.
I think it defaults to Salmon State.
Yeah, it defaults to Salmon State. That's true. So that's actually this one, the last one. Identity. I'm just going to say Hood Canal, and even though I had it in my title, I'm going to say this is an acquisition and restoration project, and I did need to save it.
This is the screen that populates the navigation bar.
Correct.
So once you do this, then
you got I'll show you that.
Yeah.
Right, and all the questions. So now you see you have a lot more items to fill in. It looked all easy before, didn't it?
There's more.
So now, and you'll see that it just keeps bumping down the items here. You just work through it. And let's see, so you got to add a work site.
having a brain seizure.
There it is. All right. And then you just provide a name, Tom's Beach, something like that. And sure, well, there's acquisition and restoration at this parcel. I'm just going to hit next. So I didn't pick a property. Alice noted. Well, and it should.
You're going to get an edit if you didn't put something in. Basically, any field that's white, you need to fill out, or else it'll give you an edit, unless it says it's optional.
Right. We'll get there, but let's just zoom in. And so now you can actually write it in, or you can put a put the dot on the map. So yeah, now you enter a description. I'm actually not going to spend a lot of time writing for you guys, but this is where you know, write what you're doing there and that you're going to acquire and protect it with acquisition, and then how to get there. Even though the if it's a different than the location, if you like have to go take a boat to an island or something, you have to put the car where the boat or where you're taking off from. Hopefully that makes sense. Anyway, I'm going to go next. So hopefully the sponsor workbench environment will work better for you.
Mapping page usually takes a long time.
Yeah.
So you can either hit next or you can navigate on the left if you want to hit like your budget or your metrics or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to do it in order.
Right. Is there anything you guys...
I think hit a metrics page just to show them how those work.
Right. So...
The key here are those pluses. Those kind of expand and minimize more options.
Right. So, like, this question is asking you whether you're going to get a conservation easement over this property or you're going to actually acquire the property fee simple. I'll say fee simple. And then you need to add the acres, add the metrics. These are the metrics we were talking about. I'm going to say no structures on site. And it probably won't let me go without any acres, huh?
It'll let you move forward in any case, but
yeah.
But one of the things that's important here on the metrics page is you're entering in, if you can scroll up a little, you're entering in the total costs here on your metrics page. So these numbers that you're going to enter in will feed your cost estimates. So you enter a value here. And then you'll see later that will pop up on your cost summary and cost estimate pages. So you can make changes in your metrics tabs here, or you can make changes on the cost estimate, and then they will also change over here. So as I mentioned in our discussion about the cost estimate attachments, for acquisitions, we actually ask you for quite a bit of detail on these incidentals. If you select different incidentals, it will ask you to how much those incidentals are going to cost. And so there's quite a bit of detail here, and so that's why we don't need that separate cost estimate for an acquisition project. It's not in this level of detail for a restoration project, but all of these incidentals, you have to actually tell us how much you estimate these things are going to cost. They are estimates, so we're not, you know, if they change, that's okay, but give your best estimate. So after Mike fills out a couple of these, and always remember to scroll all the way to the bottom for your admin, both the A&E and the restoration, or excuse me, both the acquisition and restoration have the A&E at the bottom, and sometimes folks forget that, and they don't enter in admin costs, which are really important to your success, obviously, because they're your project management costs.
This won't correct you either. Like, I'll put in $3,000, but or $30,000. But you're only allowed 5% of your acquisition costs towards admin, and if you put like $30,000 here, I'm sure that's over. No, well, maybe not. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
It might be. Anyway, it won't tell you your you're over. You'll have to look at your estimate and see what the available, what the max amount is.
We had a question about whether or not you can do this on an Apple product as well as a PC, and you can. This is a website, so you can do it on an Apple product, and you can view it on an Apple product. And all of the forms are also compatible. I mean, they're just Word forms or Excel. So if you have those programs, you can use them on your Mac. What's not compatible on an Apple or a Mac is Prism. So that's the database that you actually download. But you don't need that to submit an application. All you need is Prism Online. So you can do it from your computer at home or at work if your work uses Apples.
All right. So I'm going to keep moving on here. And I probably shouldn't have added that zero. Let's see how long it's going to take me. Okay, good. All right, excellent. So now it just bumped ahead right into the restoration metrics. And so you do need to know your species. What are you targeting here for salmon? At this point, I'm just going to say that. But yeah, you can see this is actually fairly intuitive and easy to follow. But I am right. We'll do what Mark said, beach nourishment. So cost.
Again, make sure that these are metrics that are for this phase of your project, not for like an overall project. So this is actually what you're going to achieve with your funding and the match that you're going to report. Okay, so these are all the different types of projects that we have that are eligible. So just note that these pluses and minuses expand to give you more information about what you'd need to fill out. You can either expand by selecting them, or you can also expand them just by clicking on the plus. So just click on one of the pluses, Mike. That does the same thing as, no, just on the plus. You don't need to check it.
Oh, I see.
The check is actually selecting that's what you want to choose. But if you're confused about what are the metrics that they're going to ask you, if you select that type of project, you can just choose the plus and gives you more information. So it's a way to, we don't put it all out there up front. Otherwise, this would be a crazy long page. So that's how you kind of get more information. And again, there's permits and A&E and cultural resources all the way down at the bottom. Those are really important. Make sure you, look through all of the work types before you move on. So we're just entering in some costs here so that when we get to the cost screen, we'll have something to show.
Right. This is, this I think does show the value of doing that cost estimate that you guys went over first and figuring out what your total costs are, and then filling in this part would be really super easy. Okay.
So why don't you jump ahead to the cost summary page maybe?
This was where everything rolls up. So there you go. Yeah, see, when I did put that $30,000, even though Prism takes it, it's at 11.79%, which is the max for this acquisition is $12,725. So just so you're aware of that. So you'll get an error if you continued on with this. And I'll show you
that. This is where you'll enter in how much funding you're going to request.
Right.
And the different types of match. You don't need to do it.
All right. I won't do it.
You can hit add match. There's all sorts of different
This drop down menu is important to know, but as Mark said, we almost take anything as match, but you need to define it within this framework. Okay.
The next couple of sections just are questions. So this is a good thing. Don't leave the page if you want to save it. So he hasn't if you navigate it with the navigation toolbar over on the left, you have to hit save first or else you'll lose the information from the page. Luckily, there's that pop-up that reminds you of that.
Right.
So once you save it, then you can navigate using the left-hand navigation bar.
All right, so now we're on the acquisition questions. So you'll need to fill these in if you have an acquisition project. I'm just going to flip to the restoration questions. And there, you'll see that there's a lot more.
Some of these are the culture resources questions, right, that Kay and Alice were talking about.
Mm-hmm. So you'll just need to provide a narrative and answer each of these, you know, yes, no questions. So.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So, and then there's the overall project questions. And, yeah, this is really kind of getting at if this is any, if there's mitigation involved in this project at all. And then this is where we want to know whether if you need state dollars to match a federal funding source, this is where you'd provide that answer and narrative about what you're getting and from federal funds and what you need for state. Is it on state-owned aquatic lands? Let's see. Yeah, well, anyway, you'll just need to fill in all these questions. So they're not that terribly difficult, but you just need to get plow through it. And then there's the permits. And this is another one where you'll need to add the permit with that button there and then select which one. Let's say you are working on aquatic lands. So that's actually not a permit. They'll remind us that's a use authorization, a legal document. So and then there's the permit questions that you'll need to fill in. Now, I am going to, oh, well, sheesh, I got to save. Okay, so Kay went through a lot of different attachments, and you'll see, and she mentioned that there aren't as many. There's only 7 that are required, but depending on your type of project, you may have other requirements. So just keep that in mind as you're getting through the PRISM application phase of the project. So
these are kind of the least common denominator required attachments. These are required from all project types. So that's why we have them here. And the way you get these boxes checked off is by uploading something and categorizing it as such.
Right.
Yep, so you click that.
Yeah, so this will just guide you through it. It's a wizard, you know, go to your browser. I don't know if I want to.
Just navigate to, like, documents or something, or pictures.
I know.
This is a Salmon computer, so I don't
know. Oh, that's good.
No pictures.
All right, well, I'm sure everybody here knows how to find their pictures and their items within their browser. Hopefully, if you have a question on that, send it to us. But that just walks you through it, and then it'll end up in here, and you'll need to select a title, though. Remember to do that. It'll be
type.
Is that where? The attachment type, I mean. You'll need to select an attachment type, and that's a drop-down, too. So.
Well, that's how you get the X's or the check marks off that list above. So
right.
If you attach a photo and you select attachment type photo, and it's a PDF or a JPEG, it'll check it off.
Another nice feature about this page is when you click on the attached file or photo, you can browse and select multiple files and then hit upload, and you can upload multiple files at once. You don't have to keep going in
one
and opening that attached file button. So if you have all of your stuff in one folder or something, you could dump it into PRISM in one go.
So Jennifer.
So this is a real one that somebody's actually started. So go to submit. There you go. And you're gonna head check application for errors.
Sorry, Jennifer, if you're out there. But yeah, so she's moving along through it pretty well, but there's some exclamation points. Let's see what comes up on the planning metrics. I just clicked that.
So the edits show up in red on every page and just tells you that you need to select it. It doesn't look like she's selected.
Right, she's not.
So the edits are just at the top, not at the bottom.
She just hasn't worked on this page yet, so that's fine. But that is it. And then once you get all green check marks and everything, you feel comfortable with your application, you click on the certify that you have put this together correctly, and you submit your application. Now, you should check with your lead entity coordinator on that, too, and make sure that they don't want you to just keep it open for a while they review it as well. So everybody kind of has their own ways of doing it and business rules associated with entering an application. All right, okay. And then the rest of it is our job down here, the review application. That's the project manager's role. But everything else is done. So unless anybody has any questions out there, we are through.
Thank you, everyone. We'll stay online for a couple minutes if there's any last-minute questions, but I think we're done. So.
Yeah, thanks for hanging in there.